top five records of all time. At number five, Queens of the Stone Age, Songs for the Deaf. But no one knows Go With the Flow. Dave Grohl on drums, saw them live in Raleigh. Disco Rodeo. However, Dave Grohl was not there because he was with Foo Fighters. So Adema's drummer filled in. Got to see that tour. Number five. Only reason this is at number four is because I didn't get to see them live. That's Heat Miser, Cop and Speeder from 1994 on Frontier Records. This is Elliott Smith's band before he went solo. Busted Lip, Disappearing Ink, Pastor John, killer tracks. At number three is Tool, Enema. And I saw this tour multiple times. Phenomenal. Actually, every time they came through the three states around me. Soundgarden at number two with Super Unknown. Yeah, this is an OG still in the shrink. 1994, 4th of July and Limo Wreck. Great heaviness, my favorites. And at number one, Lungfish, Indivisible on Discord Records from 97. Asa Osborne on guitar, Nothing But Groove. And Daniel Higgs, not a better songwriter in the world. That's what you got. Peace.
Today we're starting at number 40 with Keep It Like a Secret from Built to Spill from 1999. I mentioned earlier when I was talking about Belle and Sebastian that there was a batch of CDs, mostly like indie rock, indie bands that I bought from a record store that was closing. And in that batch of CDs was the album There's Nothing Wrong With Love by Built to Spill. That was the first album that I'd ever heard by Built to Spill, and I thought it was fantastic. Keep It Like a Secret, in my opinion, is kind of like the culmination of the best things about There's Nothing Wrong With Love and Perfect From Now On. Production is a lot sharper and cleaner, so you know it's got less rough edges than There's Nothing Wrong With Love. But then also the songs are a lot more focused, and the compositions are much tighter than they are on Perfect From Now On. They're more direct, accessible rock songs like Center of the Universe or Sidewalk or Time Trap. And there's still all those kind of tempo changes and left turns and meandering guitar solos, but they're just kind of wrapped up tightly in 3.5-4 minute songs. There's only one long jam, which is Broken Chairs, which is the perfect closer and a live staple. And then there's my favorite Built to Spill song, which is Carry the Zero. If anybody asked me to sum up Built to Spill in one song, it would be Carry the Zero. There are these soaring guitar solos, that cool like crescendo, that building crescendo throughout. And then just absolutely underrated lyrics, like very clever, very underrated lyrics. Number 39, I have Shoots Too Narrow by The Shins from 2003. My introduction to The Shins was O Inverted World, and I didn't really think this at the time, but looking back, that sound, that kind of pop, psych, folk kind of sound was very akin to the Elephant Six collective sound that kind of predated that album, you know, by a few years. With Shoots Too Narrow, Phil Eck comes in as producer, and he kind of cleans up the production a little bit, just a little bit, and enough to kind of make it sound like they're kind of steering in a different direction. A lot of the reverb is gone off of James Mercer's vocals, and he just sounds a little bit more naked, you know, and it kind of lends itself to his soul-bearing, you know, lyrics. There's also a lot more variety on this record. There's Baroque pop and even some country rock. And with that cleaner production, it kind of got me to focus more directly on the songwriting. Mercer kind of tackles like this predetermined fate of society and this innate unwillingness to ever achieve like the utopian dream. And So Says I. He takes on larger kind of existential matters and fighting in a sack. And of course, there's just a lot of songs where he's just kind of owning up to failures at romantic relationships. This album is just full of songs of inner struggle and strife. But inner struggle housed in really catchy pop melodies. At number 38, we have Tonight's the Night by Neil Young from 1975. Over the years, no album in his entire discography has grown on me more than this album since the first time I heard it, probably, I don't know, 20 plus years ago. Neil Young was never short on emotion. You know, and he proved that with albums like After the Gold Rush and Harvest and On the Beach. All three albums at some point that I have said were my favorite Neil Young records. But with Tonight's the Night, the emotion is just that much more intense. No Neil Young album had ever sounded like this before. The production is a lot rawer. There's no string arrangements, which we're kind of accustomed to hearing. It's a lot more bare bones. I don't remember what I was watching, but I saw Neil Young refer to it kind of as audio verite. All Neil Young fans know this album was born out of a period of grief due to the loss of Danny Whitten, and then ultimately the roadie Bruce Berry. And these sessions are just pour out your soul, bombed on tequila recordings. But it works, you know? It is messy at times, but the imperfections are kind of what makes it so perfect. Neil's vocals are very straight ahead. They don't sound like they were recorded in multiple takes. His voice is cracking everywhere. You even hear moments where he just can't hit the high notes and they just leave it on the record. That doesn't mean that there isn't some expert playing on here. And I almost feel like kind of like the dark horse MVP of the album is Nils Lofgren on piano and guitar. But yes, it's a very, very dark album. And you kind of have to be able to take that, you know, for what it is to really enjoy the beauty of it. I always kind of thought that Jason Molina almost used this album as a template for almost every album that he made. At number 37, I have The Temptations with A Lot of Soul from 1967. The three groups that my parents listened to the most when I was growing up were The Four Tops, The Supremes, and The Temptations. And their music, the music by those groups was something that I never really felt the need to rebel against. You know, 1967 is talked about a lot for the psychedelic rock of that era, but there was a lot of really great soul R&B records that came out in 1967, like full albums. They're really, really good. Some of the greatest of all time, you know, and I think that this is one of them. There's not a bad song on this album. And a lot of their contemporaries would have been happy to have even the worst songs on this record for their own discography. I Know I'm Losing You, All I Need, and You're My Everything were all top 10 singles on the pop charts. And Loneliness made me realize It's You That I Need. It was, I think it reached like 15 on the pop charts. And that's four incredibly strong singles. But songs like Sorry Is a Sorry Word, Just One Look, the Paul Williams feature, No More Water in the Well, all three of those songs could have charted too. Every member of the group is really contributing on this album. Like I also love Don't Send Me Away, which is the album closer, which is fronted by Otis Williams and Melvin Franklin. So in the last video, I talked about how James Carr was one of my three favorite male R&B soul singers. And David Ruffin is also one of those three. I Know I'm Losing You is, in my opinion, his absolute finest moment in a plethora of great moments during the time that he was with the group. At number 36, I have Sticky Fingers by the Rolling Stones from 1971. Yeah, so this is the point in this list of albums when I tell you that no, Exile on Main Street isn't my favorite Rolling Stones record. And for many years, I would have told you that Exile was my absolute favorite. But I think that I was actually being kind of heavily influenced by rock critics and music journalists and film documentarians. When I sit down and listen to those albums, it's really undeniable that Sticky Fingers is my favorite. It's the country rock leaning tunes on this album, like Wild Horses, that are just right in my wheelhouse. Dead Flowers is actually my favorite. This album has two of my all-time favorite Rolling Stones songs. Can't You Hear Me Knockin' has one of my all-time favorite guitar riffs, and then that jam. That jam is absolutely incredible. The congas, Billy Preston's organ, Bobby Keys' saxophone solo. Easily one of the greatest kind of happy accidents that ever made it onto a record. And then there's Moonlight Mile, which is just... I love songs that are about like the stress of touring life. There's always... The road is always mentioned, like dangerous roads, treacherous roads, long roads. and these types of songs just kind of serve as like the perfect metaphor for life in general. And it's all in that song. Just a beautiful, beautiful song. I can't really call it overlooked because I think a lot of people really like that song. But I don't know, maybe it is compared to all of their hits. I can't believe it's one of my favorite Rolling Stones songs and it doesn't even have Keith on it.
Okay, John, you asked me to talk about favorite albums. I'm gonna talk about my favorite album, which is no secret that it is Genesis, The Lamb Lies Down on Broadway from 1974. The final album to include Peter Gabriel within the band. This is a timeless album for me. It's been a favorite for years and years. This is Genesis at maybe their most adventurous, creative. The band members are exceptional musically. The album is a double album, is a concept album. Written by Peter Gabriel, the concept and the story. When it was recorded, Peter Gabriel focused on writing the story while the remaining four band members, Phil Collins, Steve Hackett, Tony Banks, and Mike Rutherford, went and worked on the music. Just a masterpiece in my opinion. The music flows almost like one continuous piece of music. And it is exceptional, in my opinion, and my all-time favorite album.
At number 35, I have Z by My Morning Jacket from 2005. I first got into My Morning Jacket around 2002. A friend of mine had talked about how she really liked them a lot. Shortly after that, It Still Moves came out. I ended up seeing them on that tour. Absolutely amazing rock show. They all had hair like way down in their face, super long hair. You never really saw their faces the entire time they were playing. Kind of Southern rock, Southern influence on rock and roll with this kind of indie bent. They were just the perfect kind of rock band for me at that moment in time. And then Z came out. And if I'm completely honest, I was a little perplexed by it at the time. It just had like cleaner production. They worked with John Leckie, who had produced the Stone Roses and also did Radiohead's The Bends. And I think when he came in, you know, his production style really kind of created some twists and turns that were kind of unexpected, you know, at least by me at the time. And I think a lot of other My Morning Jacket fans. And the sound of the band and the record just, you know, they just went for the rafters, you know, with this one. And I was kind of worried that like the intimacy of their first three records was something that I was just going to sorely miss. But then I saw them tour this album and any worries just went out the window. And it was just obvious, you know, they were a full-fledged rock and roll band now. Songs like Gideon and Anytime were totally built to be played like in rock stadiums. But here I was hearing them played in like a small rock club, and it just made the experience all that much more special. But the intimacy is still there. Like, I was wrong about that on initial listens. You know, Knot Comes Loose is a beautiful stripped back song. Lay Low has this real kind of like 70s soul infused kind of Americana, very reminiscent of the band and Elton John. And then there's the closer, Don Dante, which just has this beautiful, slow, very slow build into this just mountain peak of a jam, like in the middle, you know, only for you to kind of come down the other side of the mountain with that sax solo, you know, right into the last note, which just breathes and exhales out, you know, into complete silence. But Z is their creative peak, in my opinion. It's everything that you need from My Morning Jacket, and just an incredible, incredible rock and roll record. At number 34, I have Automatic for the People by R.E.M. from 1992. I cannot overstate how much of a part of my life and the lives of my peers and friends that R.E.M. was throughout the 90s, starting with the popularity of Losing My Religion off of Out of Time, all the way up through Adventures in Hi-Fi. But for me, especially, Automatic for the People and Monster were huge, heavy rotation for me through high school. I mean, me and my friends, we were also listening to the IRS stuff, you know, the IRS years. And it's funny because I never really called R.E.M. like one of my favorite bands at the time. But when I look back on it and just how much they were just around and being played all the time, I have so many memories related to Automatic for the People. You know, this album being played like in my art classes, you know, we could listen to music while we were, you know, working, and to being in friends' bedrooms, you know, listening to this record. I even have these like distinct memories, very specific memories of songs from this record, like these two friends of mine that were sisters, and us hanging out outside at night, and the two of them like slow dancing under the stars to this a cappella version of Night Swimming. You know, they were just singing it themselves. And then one of my friends would also tell me all the time that she could hear my name in Sidewinder Sleeps Tonight, which was, I always thought was kind of funny. It was, you know, a weird memory, but it was there. Also, I was a fan of Andy Kaufman at kind of an unusually young age. I used to love seeing his performances on like reruns of SNL. And I mean, this was like in middle school, you know? And I first saw the comedy, it's really like a comedy special because it was in on the joke, but it was presented as a documentary. I'm From Hollywood, which was all about his wrestling days and has just these very awkward interviews with like Tony Danza and Robin Williams. And so when I first heard Man on the Moon, and those Andy Kaufman references, I never felt cooler. I don't think I've still felt cooler since then, since that moment, because I'm not cool. I'm a dork. It's also kind of ironic that there were so many of us, these teens, that were really into this record about, you know, coming to grips with mortality and loss and, you know, the band members like coming into their 30s. But to this day, that's why it's really my favorite REM album. Aside from the fact that it just sounds like nothing else in their catalog. I mean, sure, it's called their like acoustic album, but those string arrangements from John Paul Jones and everything is just what it needs to be. It's not overproduced and over embellished. It's just, everything is just perfect, like the way it is. At number 33, I have Things Fall Apart by The Roots from 1999. I've mentioned in earlier videos how I wasn't really like that huge into hip hop like throughout the 90s, but then everything changed once I discovered Outkast and The Roots especially. How they weaved in jazz into their sound, it was perfect because it was kind of right at the same time that I was really beginning to really listen to jazz a lot for the first time. It was actually this album. It was actually Do You Want More? That changed my entire relationship with hip hop. You know, they were obviously influenced by Tribe and De La Soul and Digable Planets, but they really kind of achieved that kind of more organic sound by also sounding very, very modern. And they were able to do that because they were an actual band. The intro to Things Fall Apart, they would always include these intros on all of their albums. And the one on Things Fall Apart is perfect. It's a scene. It's audio from a scene from Mo' Better Blues, which is Spike Lee's film about a jazz musician, and Denzel Washington's character is having this argument with Wesley Snipes' character about the racial makeup of his audience, you know, that he was performing for. And then it kind of moves into transitions into this like blurb about like art versus commerce. And it just, to me, it's the perfect intro because it sets you up for exactly what you're going to hear on this record. I mean, hip hop is art. It is an art form. I truly believe that. But the way The Roots do it, there's just, you know, they take some chances. They're challenging like their listeners, you know. But yeah, The Roots, they're my favorite hip hop group by far. I mean, Black Thought's my favorite MC. And that's been for a long time before he blew everybody's mind with that freestyle like a few years ago. And then Questlove has, for me personally, been a musical guru. Like, you know, especially when I let him, he's never steered me in a wrong direction at all. Do You Want More might have played a more important role in my life, but Things Fall Apart is just the better album and, you know, my favorite. My favorite Roots record. See if you can handle it. Check it out. You got the groove. MCs, freeze, stand still. Nobody move unless you're dealing with the next movement. The P5D, we beat them on you, man. I live my life nice, but I'm not you, man. You theatrical as a four-way play. This ain't rent. 100% straight out the basement. Spreading this across the planet on some next, y'all. How many people feeling this love music? Come on. So at number 32, we have A Love Supreme by John Coltrane from 1965. My final entry from the Jazz 101 catalog. So yeah, I got into this record not long after Kind of Blue and Ming Is Alam. It was just kind of, it was the next step, you know, the next typical step. I'm not the most eloquent speaker in general. I'm definitely not the most eloquent speaker about jazz. So I'll spare everybody you know, trying to talk about the music part of this record. I'm not really like a person of faith, you know, I'm not really a believer. But there was a time in my life when I was very active in the youth ministry or fellowship of the Episcopal Church, the diocese of the Episcopal Church in the area in which I grew up. And I made a lot of friends through that, friends that I still have to this day, some of my best friends that I'm still close with, no matter like where we are in our spiritual journeys. And I actually discovered this album at a time when I was kind of on my way out of that world and being involved with all of that. But I guess I still felt like I maybe had like a strong faith. I don't know. It was kind of the beginning of me moving away from it. And it's funny, you know, this record, instead of emboldening my faith and my belief, what it really did was it kind of helped me realize that I didn't need doctrine or liturgy or any faith at all to feel something spiritual. But it's really one of those albums that anybody can, I believe, can appropriately experience it without having any real appreciation for jazz at all. Like, you know, at least appreciation for jazz in the classic sense. It's just powerful, powerful music. I can confidently say that I'd be fine with this being the only jazz album that I ever owned, to be completely honest. It's that powerful to me. At number 31, I have Access Bold as Love by the Jimi Hendrix Experience from 1967. Hendrix was, for me, what the Beatles probably were for a lot of other people. He was like my exposure, my gateway to music from like the prior generations that still seemed like really, really relevant. I mean, I absolutely wore out my CD of Smash Hits. I mean, all three of his proper studio albums are absolutely incredible. You know, the first one, the debut, being more direct, an Electric Ladyland probably being his most adventurous album, at least sonically. And then Axis just kind of sits perfectly in the middle. It's his songwriting on this album that makes it my favorite. I mean, sure, the lyrics are still full of flowers and rainbows and shit, but it's his emotive vocal delivery. Like, he's such an underrated singer. It's just that emotive vocal delivery that really elevates this music over the psychedelic pastiche that was being like mass produced at the same time. One Rainy Wish is my favorite deep cut. One of my favorite Hendrix songs. I just love it. It's just the kind of fluttering guitar that starts the track off, and then his more kind of gentle like vocals, but then all of a sudden that bridge just kicks into that bridge and it just explodes. And every time I'm in the car, I have to like back it up and hear that part again, you know, when it kicks in and just says, I have never. Sorry, I can't believe that. but you know what I mean? Like, it's just never underestimate an incredible bridge. But of course, the best moments are Little Wing and Bold as Love. Those soaring guitar solos. Just incredible songs. I think his two best songs. In my opinion, his two best songs. Yeah, I mean, Hendrix is the best. He's the best guitarist that ever lived. He's my personal favorite, but I also think he was the best that ever lived. All right, that'll be it for today. Thanks everybody that's stuck with this. Thanks for your comments and your back and forth. That's been kind of the best part of this. And yeah, we're getting closer to the end. Getting there. It's taken long enough, for sure. But I hope everybody's doing okay. And we'll see you in the next one. All right.
Digital gramophone makes no sense.